Hello, and welcome to SpaceChem. Somebody asked me real nicely to do a solution video on how to solve a puzzle in SpaceChem, so I thought I'd give it a try. There were a lot that I've solved already. Like, I've done a lot of ResearchNet assignments, especially in Volumes 5 and before. So I thought this one will probably be okay for... this one. This one ought to be okay for a video, because it's one that I haven't done before. It's relatively easy, and it's a research assignment instead of a production assignment, so I don't have to go into laying out multiple reactors. The puzzle will just be right here. So generally, there's lots of excellent videos on how the game mechanics in SpaceChem work already, so I'm not going to go over the basic stuff like inputs and outputs and how these bonders work and whatnot. I'm just going to be laying down the commands and whatnot, but I'm just going to be trying to go over the high-level concepts of how I generally put together a solution. And not just any solution, I am going to try and get a reasonably efficient one here as well. So, let's take a look at our tools. We have the bonders and the sensor. It's worth taking note of every single tool you have, because sometimes you'll have an unexpected resource like a quantum tunnel or a fuser that you might not necessarily think you need from the inputs and the outputs, but you might think of something to do with them later, just because you notice you have them. I mean, you'll see them sooner or later, but it's good to take notice of them now. Anyway, so we have single square inputs, I should say, so there's only one place you can actually grab them. Like, you're gonna need a grab on their square. You can grab, multiple square outputs from any square that they're on, and that can occasionally be useful, but in this case, we're just gonna grab them right here. Gonna need to input. So I'm thinking that, the first thing I'm thinking is that, you need to always ask yourself, where do you put your bonders? There's excellent videos on this already, but to make a long story short, you want to either put them near the inputs, near the middle, or near the outputs. Now, I think for this particular puzzle, since we're going to be doing so much bonding to make a complicated output, and we need so many single atoms, it's going to make sense to put our bonders right on the chlorine. And specifically on the chlorine and not the gold, because there's more chlorines in the output than there are golds. So, we're probably going to want something like this, I should guess. Just because every single bond in this output involves a chlorine. If there were, more, gold-gold bonds or chlorine-chlorine bonds, maybe I'd consider a shape more like this, but this seems like a, this seems like something fine to start out with. Maybe I'll want something like this later, where, you'll have a chlorine and then a gold and something else here later, maybe. But, that's probably close to what we want. Around the same time, you also want to consider, what shape of output you're going to be going for. In this case, I think this is the only shape we can actually make, but sometimes you can really squash or stretch or rotate your molecule around to a more convenient shape, and again, that might affect where you want to put these. So you might notice that, again, we're not necessarily going to be doing much grabbing of these chlorines. I'm going to try and do my best to just bond them, on the fly as necessary. We'll see where that goes. So, there's multiple ways to do this, but I'm thinking probably the easiest way to just start out with is just going to be having red grab one gold and blue grab one gold, stack some chlorines on one, stack some chlorines on the other, and then bond both of those halves together. That might be the easiest way to do this. There's a certain bottlenecking of how quickly can we get these chlorines in and bonded. But we'll just have to see where that takes us. So we'll probably want to start with, this. I mean, really, we could just cut this in half and make two T-shapes. So maybe we just want to start with that, see where that takes us. In fact, we could have blue help us a little bit here. So I want blue to come in one square behind. They'll hang out back here. So, in fact, we'll probably want it to be like this. So red always happens first and blue happens last, so that's, you're gonna see what this does. And if I've set it up correctly, it should be, neat, hopefully. Whoops. Right, that's not fast enough. So actually maybe we just want blue to go first. so I'll turn all these blue. And I'll turn all these red, with the exception of that. And maybe we won't even need the sink. Let's see. Right, so I'll just move those back. Fair enough. Right, but then I'll have to swap these out. Okay, well, I guess I'm not really saving time here after all, but it was worth a try. Okay, I think we're actually at somewhere where we can actually go now. So the idea is, red is going to input an alpha first, blue will grab. This is the most efficient way to, you know, start grabbing your input and start moving it somewhere, is have red take it and blue grab it on the very first cycle you can and start moving it immediately. Then red can follow up with another input, but generally he'll need to wait around and delay a little bit while blue clears out the area. Now next, red is going to input beta and blue is going to bond plus, which will cause this to happen quite nicely. And now blue can actually just keep going. So it doesn't need to, like, do any kind of drops or grabs. It doesn't need to circle back around on itself. It can just keep being on the move. And this helps you optimize the use of space here. Space is at a premium in these reactors because you have very little squares, and particularly because the bonders tend to get really clogged up. You always need to really pay very close attention to what shape the paths are around your bonders. So anyway, so we've got that built. We can build something very similar once again. I guess we'll do this. Again, this is probably not going to be what our final solution looks like, but this is just for starters. So we need to time that like so. Yeah, so in theory, we could time this a little bit better so that red was one cycle ahead, but again, I'll worry about that later. So once again, red inputs and blue bonds. So now we have two of these. So instead of sending this way, I'll want to do a final bond, of course, where the gold ends up attached to this chlorine. So actually, I kind of want this to be dropped over here. Yeah, on this, like, I want the gold to be on this square and the chlorine to be over here, I think. So that way I can bond it upwards and I'll be able to carry the whole thing upwards, you'll see. So how's that gonna happen? Like, that's one way. But then I kind of want the gold to be over there. Well, I can do that, that's not hard. If I attach them in this order, then I can just put this right here, and then there's no problem. Of course, I will have to move red back over to the start, but that's here's another thing. You don't necessarily need to input things on the exact turn that you want to bond them at the same time, especially in research assignments like this where you can just input things as fast as you want them to. Sometimes, you know, you can get tunnel vision about inputting something and bonding it on the same turn, where sometimes you want to move your input back, input it, you know, have it be ready for you, and then bond it later. And the reason for that is moving this back here allows me to conveniently reuse this path and use a flip-flop and escape, and I can send it over this way. So this should actually do nearly everything I want. Now I just have to lead blue back around. Yeah, so that shape still happens, that's going to be dropped over at the right spot, and now I just need to lead blue back around and probably rotate this twice. Yeah, that'll be fine, though. Yeah, so let's just see where that gets us. Because now you can, like, bond this once and then again, probably, and then lead it up here. Drop it somewhere over there and then come back. So you can see that now my master plan has come to fruition. We're gonna need to... Yeah, this is still on the bonders, though, so I'm gonna need to debond it, rebond it like so, and then carry it up. So that will get rid of those bonds, and now the bonds will be added back on. But now we still have the problem that, yeah, that extra bond got added. But you can see we're pretty darn close already. So I guess the other question is how we're going to drop this in the output zone. Dropping something in the output zone can actually be kind of subtle, because it's not always easy to say exactly how you want to drag something over there. In this case, since we're holding on to this, like, leading edge of the molecule, we might want to drop it and grab it and then rotate it. We'll have to see, though. So, I guess probably the easiest way to solve this part will be to do another sync, because I think we can solve this by having red do a debond right at this cycle, and then blue will reuse this bond plus, and then, again, we'll do a similar thing where that gets debonded and rebonded, and then there will be a single bond. So, might as well do that. Let's see. Red is not in no hurry to really, you know, get back to the start, because they're doing some delays anyway, so let's just see where it ends up if we send it over this way. So we'd want to hit it right here. Alright, well, let's do that. And then I guess we want to do the drop, grab, and rotate like I was talking about. So then I guess the question is it more efficient to put it here or here? Well, that's one fewer rotates, so probably here. Alright, let's just see where that gets us. We'll fix the synchronization at the start when we're done. I just want to make sure we're outputting one output correctly. And bond minus bond plus, there we go. There's our output. Rotate it. And drop an out. And in fact, yeah, now the problem is that blue is actually the one that goes first, so I don't think we actually want blue to be the one responsible for putting in the output. And that's for two reasons. One is, of course, we want it to be over here so it can restart its cycle real quick. But we also want, there's gonna be another thing with priority that's gonna be involved here. And to explain that properly, we're gonna need to do this part first. I'm gonna make red responsible for dropping this in the output while blue goes ahead. So red kinda needs to waste a little bit of time, but then eventually grab this, this chlorine here, probably. So let's just see what that looks like. Yeah, something like that, but faster. Alright. We might need a one-turn delay here. Probably because, yeah, we want it to be right here. So, alright, fine. We can arrange that. In fact, here's a real clever way of doing it. We can abuse a flip-flop to get that. That will do the job of going down here and then back up. Now the question is that going to be off by two cycles, though? Yes, it will. Because you'll see that we are getting that one turn delay here where it needs to enter the square, turn the flip-flop on, and then go up. And that does waste one turn. But the problem is the loop went all the way down here and back up, which is two turns too many. So for that to really work effectively, it's gonna have to. Yeah, we're gonna need a sync. Fair enough. And if we're gonna do that, well, yeah, I guess we'll work with this shape for now. Although, actually, again, there's no particular reason why, we'll worry about that reconfiguration later. Well, yeah, it kind of saves symbols, so we might as well do it now. We'll get rid of this in beta, and we can reuse this so that instead of going up here and then across and then down and then up, we'll save symbols by reusing this loop to go down, and then we'll just go across and then up, which is the same, like, kind of Manhattan length as our previous setup was. This saves symbols, and then we can move the in beta over to blue's track, because blue doesn't have to reuse any of this space. So we can put a blue input beta over here. And that will do the same thing. And that frees us up to put a sync in an appropriate spot, which is, again, also kind of tricky. Yeah, because we want to grab it right here. I mean, that's kind of the downside of reusing space like this, is you can't really effectively put a sink here without clogging stuff up more. So fair enough. We'll go back to the original here. Okay, get rid of that. Put a sink on this track. Ideally so that this will just hit this in an appropriate time. So we'll put the sink here. And blue sink will go here. And that will jam red up by one cycle here. Alright, so exactly one cycle. And now I can grab this with the appropriate timing. So now it'll go up and drop it, and then red will grab this, and that won't waste too much time, sort of. I mean, time is still being wasted here, don't get me wrong. This is not the most efficient solution. We'll hopefully get near that soon enough, but we'll get near that. Now we can drop certain those. And the most important part of this is that now blue can go straight up, and now they're nice and close to the start again. Red is still a little bit far away from their track, but we might be able to work with that. We'll see. Right, but I need to retime this. What happened here? Right, I just never did this part again. Well, fair enough. So red is currently still pretty far away. It is 2, 4, 6, 7 away from its goal. Which is fine. We'll have to fix that in post, I guess. Well, alright, let's just finish this off first. We'll worry about optimizing it later. So you might notice that I've deliberately left out red's output here, and the reason for that is I'm going to put a blue output here, which will once again take advantage of the Waldo priority here. Red will go first, and it will let go of the molecule and drop it in the output zone, and blue will actually issue the output command, which will output it on that precise cycle. Normally you would have to drop it and then move the Waldo over to the output, and the output would happen one cycle the next cycle, because you'd have to move your Waldo physically over to the next square and then hit that command. But because both of these happen in one cycle, we're actually saving one cycle here. And again, that's an important facet of most solutions, is they will have red drop your output over in the output and have blue output it. Most importantly, it's important to do that with the last output, the 10th one, or the 40th one on a production assignment. It doesn't necessarily matter if you do that with earlier ones so much as you do that with a late one. Now, of course, blue is ahead of red here, so we're gonna have some problems here. So, I guess... Well, we're gonna be wasting symbols no matter what, so I guess we're gonna just have to do it, suck it up like this, I guess. Actually, that's a little bit inconvenient, as it turns out. Yeah, because the output is up here. Yeah, so we kind of just need blue to wait a lot longer here, so maybe just add another loop here. I mean, I don't like doing that, but that's what's going to have to work here. Sure. I mean, I could just move these starts around wherever I want. As long as they're the exact same distance away from the grab. So that can help you, again, save spaces for other commands as well. So drop. Alright, so it needs to be delayed 2 more turns, because you can see that it's exactly on the grab when red is 2 away from the input alpha that needs to be hitting. So again, this is pretty awkward. Like, you don't want to be delaying your solution intentionally like this. But it's just necessary because of the way I have it set up. So this might be it now. And there you go. Now they're synchronized. So this will work. It's not very fast, as you can see, but it's decent. Like, just a simple approach can sometimes get you pretty decently well on the leaderboards here. Like, we are a little bit symbol heavy because I did a little bit of redundant work here because I, you know, I did the same thing twice. like, you saw that I built a T with one and a T with another, and the only reason that I did that twice was so that one could be over here and the other one could be over there. There's obviously a bit of redundancy going on here, but we're not really focused on symbols right now, or we're focused on cycles. For the upcoming tournament, well, I'm not going to even talk about that, but sometimes you want to compete on symbols instead of cycles, but you just want to be clear on that when you're starting out. So let me see. So here's the interesting part, is now I have to see, do I want to try and tweak this approach to make something very similar go faster, or do I want to rethink this entirely? So just for starters, let's just analyze what's going on with this solution the way it is right now. So right now we're doing pretty efficient work with bonding on the chlorines. We're wasting like one cycle here where this, you know, blue has to pass over this flip-flop, red has to actually get into position. But then after that, it does keep bonding on chlorines pretty well. Now there's a bit of downtime where blue is waiting around. Blue is not actually in position to get here. Ideally it would be like, it would follow in right behind this and then do bonds on immediately. But the need for these rotates is a bit unfortunate. Yeah, because it's not in position. You want to minimize the use of rotates if you can, unless you're really using it to either free up space or just move your molecule large distances. Otherwise, they take up time like this, and that is slowing everything down appreciably. You know, after this, it takes... Because I did my... bonding near the inputs, I do still need a little bit of work to transport them all the way over to the output, but that's, sometimes that's like, you can't do much about it, and other times you can do some stuff about it. Like, I think this, this grab on the edge and rotating is helping appreciably, because I only need to carry it over here. Well, here's one more thing we can do. Remember when I was talking about grabbing and rotating possibly not being super helpful? So here's one thing we can do about it. Right now, this particular loop protrusion is going all the way over to the right. So one simple thing we can do that doesn't require any kind of reanalysis or anything is we can just add in one more rotate and put in a drop. Let's get a quick count of what our solution total was before this. It was 335 cycles. It's important to... This is an unfortunate aspect of the interface here, is you need to go to this this particular screen in order to see the actual result that you had. If you go on this screen, it'll just tell you your best cycle count, regardless of what your cycle count was for your actual run. That isn't actually displayed on this screen at all. So you need to like flip back to this, so you can see that this was 335. So we're going to save a few cycles, like I said, by doing this. And this is going to save one cycle per run, as you'll see. Because we're going to be adding one cycle here for the rotate, but losing two cycles here by not going over as far. So we just need to retime our one of these. Because it will happen... See, the other issue is that the drop command is all the way up here. So even though our circuit length is shorter, the actual time that the product gets output is actually latent. So the way that that works is even though we're subtracting, like, it's one cycle per every 10 attempts, the 10th output is actually, let's see, it's going to be a few cycles later, so it's going to be like 3 or 4. So this will overall be worth it, but you have to watch out for that. Sometimes it's not. We're going to need to retime that output command too, of course. I just need to see what square it's going to be on. It's going to be that one. So yeah, it's two cycles later. Which is fine. We can deal with that. So let's see. Now I think it's going to look something like this. We're going to use our flip-flop to delay this by one cycle, so we'll move the output over. And this should help save us symbols again. So flip-flop delay, go over there, and then drop it out. You can see we're down to 328 now, which, again, isn't much, but it's an improvement. Gotta look out for stuff like that. Alright, so I'll try and do a few more iterations before I quit here. Yeah, this is probably not going to cut the mustard. We can probably... The issue with doing the rotates right now is that we want to do these bonds immediately, so it's kind of tied up with not being able to do the rotates yet. And it also needs to do the sync. So let's just get rid of the sync. Maybe we don't need that quite yet. I'm wondering if we can do the rotates here and then work out the timing a bit better later. Because obviously this would help. Being able to shorten this path. I mean, that looks a little bit better. It's not much better, but it's a little bit better. So, red bond minuses, that gets added on. We're gonna need to do that again, but that's also fine. And yeah, it's one cycle off because we never did the sync, but that's okay. So let's just assume that this is okay. And just see what this looks like for now. I definitely advocate running your solutions often to see what the issue is here. Yeah, now we're running into the problem where red is too far ahead, so it does need to be delayed by a cycle at some point. So maybe we can have it wait here, because it should only run over this square once. The issue with that is the timing is a little bit off. But again, it's not really, and blue is kind of jammed up on symbols as it is. Yeah, so maybe it can wait here. Yeah, maybe it can wait here. We'll get rid of that, and we'll put that here. Sync will go here, and then that sync will go there. Maybe that'll work. Right, now the timing's off for that, naturally. Alright, hold on. We can fix that again by having red input its own. So move that over there. Do that. So you can see that, again, this is the organic production of spaghetti code. Well, that's not good. Yeah, we don't need that bond command anymore. Blue's no longer necessary to do that part. So now... Well, we need to move this stuff back. And now red is arriving here with perfect timing. So now blue will drop, red will grab, we'll do all this again, but now... well, that's obviously an issue, so we'll go over... Yeah, we'll rotate it and go up like this. Yeah, there we go. So we'll go here, and we'll need an arrow here, but we can do this. Now, is that any better? We probably don't actually really want that. We'll turn this into an up, and then we can save the symbol like that. And that's no good anymore. But we can do this. Okay. Well, we can do this. Yeah, I thought that was gonna work, but it just barely clipped the top. Collision detection in SpaceChem, I believe it's pixel perfect. As can be evidenced here. I mean, this is more symbol-heavy, but I don't really care, so it's gonna have to look like that, I guess. Hold on, why am I rotating it that way? If I'm doing two rotates, I might as well just do it this way. Right? Yeah, just do this. Swing through the bottom where I've got plenty of room? Sure. Let's not go crazy here, but, might as well take advantage of what we can. Yeah, there we go. So this should be a little bit faster, because I've cut out a little bit of space here. 308. So we're getting somewhere, but I think we do need one more approach, because this is pretty clearly not in the league of 247. Because, of course, let me see, what's the proper mathematical term for this? Like, the amount of effort you need to do incremental, like, linear decreases of your cycle time, it becomes, like, quadratic or exponential as you get closer and closer to zero. So it takes a lot of effort to really shave off those last few cycles. And even though this is a pretty cool solution, I don't think it's going to be what's actually necessary for getting the really fast time on this. So I've already got this on footage. That, you know, it would be a fine time to take a screenshot or switch to another profile or something. Save your old solution. Definitely still save it for reference. But it is time to start again from scratch. Now, what else can we do? This was a nice start, but we might be able to do something else if we can just kind of build the whole thing at once. So maybe we want red to follow very much, like, a lot closer behind. And we didn't even use that sensor either. The sensor, like, it can help. It's helpful for making special cases and making flip-flops that don't just, like, turn on and off every one couple of cycles. You can do a lot of better special case handling with that. I didn't end up using it just because it didn't make sense for control flow, but sometimes you can make pretty good use out of it. Just didn't do it that time. So here's my other plan. I'm going to do this. I'm going to kind of get Red's gold in there more immediately, and then try and have either, well, probably Red finish up the job. So they're going to try and just smush all of these atoms more closely together and just tack on all these bonds just one after another and build the whole thing in a kind of ad hoc manner rather than stitching two perfectly symmetrical halves together. Sometimes you just need the ad hoc solution. It's just how it goes. So let's see. So ideally we'll bond on one chlorine every couple of cycles, I think. Yeah, so we'll have blue drop at this point, I think. Yeah, and then have, like, red rotate, I guess, and then try and finish it up. And then do something wiggly in order to get over here. Something like that, I guess. We'll see. And then blue can just kind of go back up here or something. Again, paths don't have to be, you know, set in stone or anything. Actually, probably the better place for the rotate is down here. Well, that's a little bit awkward. Okay, well, there's no reason to move it down yet, so it can go over here to start out with. And, well, maybe input, I don't know. Oh, here's a fun error. Here, you don't often see this, but blue is trying to move downwards and red is trying to move right. As long as both of the molecules are moving in the same direction, that's fine. But because red is trying to move right and blue is trying to move down, that will cause a reaction error. So you do need to drop one of them at the appropriate time. So let's see. Is there any appropriate time for this? I mean, there's no reason for blue to go down that way, so it can just head over that way. I don't think blue has any further business over here, although sometimes you can do some funny business with grabbing one of these and then dropping it somewhere else, but that's not going to be necessary with this bonder structure, since there's no reason to put a chlorine on any of these other tiles for right now. So blue will just go away from the bonders, and that's fine. This leaves red free to do what exactly? Well, I could have blue input a thing and then drop it over here, but that's not any different from dropping it and then doing the input now, so that's not much better. In fact, red should probably rotate. Can't really do the flip-flop that well. Well, maybe I can, you know, do this. Because I'm thinking, like, it needs to rotate, but then there's no room for the rotate, so. Alright, we'll see. Although, actually, maybe we can do it like this and then reuse some space. How about that? Yeah, let's see what this looks like. Yeah, of course it'll have to go down here, but it can... We'll fix that. So we'll input beta and bond, but then we should be able to input beta on the way back and bond again. Yeah, there we go. Now we're getting some work done. And now we'll be able to fit in the chlorine here. And then the last one is going to have to be a special case, but that's fine. Yeah, so we've used this pair of bonders, this pair of bonders, and we're about to use this bottom pair and that bottom pair. Is there any particular reason we want to rotate it this way? What if we rotate it the other way? Then that gap will appear... Well, it goes like that, and we don't want that because that's awkward. Yeah, that's just going to be a worse shape overall. Like, even if we fix that, move it up here, rotate, and then go over here, it'll crash into the left side, and that's not what we want. So, let's just stay the current course. So, bond that here. And then we're going to need one last rotate here. Then it's going to have to go over here, something like that. We'll get one last one added on. Like here. And then we'll have to do another drop, grab, rotate, most likely. Or maybe blue can... No, blue is to start out. So yeah, red will fall behind. And still red will be responsible for putting this in here. So that's okay. So yeah, I would do a... I think it would drop, grab here, in fact. Yeah, that would be the most efficient way of doing it. I mean, I guess it doesn't really matter that much. And we'll shrink this loop as necessary. Bond that on, rotate that. And now, in this space of dropping and grabbing, that gives blue just enough time to do an input beta and bond plus at this spot. Like so, drop, bond plus, and then red goes off. So now I can do one more rotate and wound up in the correct spot. And this will save us a little bit of effort here. In fact, we may be able to... Yeah, since it never needs to actually go up in here, we can flatten the loop out even a little bit more. And make it go like this. Which is just, you know, aesthetically pleasing. Right, we needed one more rotate. Was that right? Yeah, because it looks like this and we want the opposite end. And blue is not especially helpful here, because blue wants to be over here. Red also needs to be fairly close, so yeah, it still needs to be all red's job here. And because of that rotation not fitting, yeah, it's gonna have to be like that, I guess. Oh well. Alright, and how many spaces is that off, in fact? Yeah, I wasn't expecting this loop to be so long, but it takes a long time to go from here to here, as it turns out. This is a bit of an awkwardly shaped product because, there's no atom in the corner. But yet, this still needs to take up the entire space. So I think it actually makes a big difference what you're holding on to at the end of this synthesis. It would be really convenient if I could be holding on to this already at the end. Although I do like being able to rotate this twice in order to get over there faster. So maybe it's just, you know, maybe I'm just complaining too much. Like, there's almost something going on here with blue. Blue nearly being in the correct spot. Maybe you could cut across here and then grab it and take it up one square at the appropriate time. Or do a rotate somehow. Like, grab this and then rotate it once and then put it up here. Well, let's just see what that looks like. We can probably swing that. Because that would it doesn't really do that much. No. Because you can see it's already, in order to line that up, we'd have to delay blue, and that's the opposite of what we want, so there you have it. Might as well just stay the course, and extend this rectangle a little bit more, I guess. Not happy about that, but that's the way it is. Alright, so Blue will output, and red will drop, but we still need to delay blue by one more. And that should do it. Alright, that should get us a nice solution. Ah, 278 cycles. That's not bad. So we're still a little bit off. There's a bit of an inefficiency we can probably fix, but that's still enough of an improvement that we advanced up a little few cycles. Alright, so 39 symbols. That's, I mean, well, that was from another solution entirely. Let me remind myself once again. No, it actually was 39 symbols. We actually cut out a few. Yeah, because we've got shorter circuits, and I think there's fewer arrows than in the other one. Yeah, I'm not using as many flip-flops. It's just two loops with this little attachment here at the end. Alright. Well, there's clearly more work left to be done, but there's other alternate scenarios, like there's other ways of putting this molecule together that I could probably eventually think of, but there you go. Two different ways of solving a decently easy puzzle, but there's definitely a lot of subtlety involved in trying to cram this thing together as fast as you possibly can. Alright, well, I might make some videos of this later, but that's probably enough for now, so until next time.